supernaturally in her life to draw her close to you. Father, we pray that tonight we would have a heart for missions like never before. Let us hear from you, and may you be glorified in tonight's service. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.
Amen.
Now, we're only going to let the little ones go tonight, second grade and under, but before we do, would you like to come ahead? Jonathan grew up in Bolivia, and Karen grew up in North Carolina, and they started out going down not to start a church. I know how that goes. Not just to be a help to the local church, but you know what? God loves the local church, and it's called them to start a church. They'll tell you all about it. We're absolutely delighted you're here. Are you going to show the video first? If you are, then we'll let the children stay in for that and just some children after. Would that be all right? Okay, let's go ahead and show the missions video, and then we will dismiss the children.
And we're Jonathan and Kara Asbun, and we're missionaries serving in Bolivia with a mission to every nation.
About 5 years ago, the Lord put it in our hearts to come down to Bolivia and serve the people here by way of discipling and reaching others with the love of God.
God has opened so many doors. It's been really amazing to see the opportunities that He's given us to be able to reach the people with His love and salvation. And we want to share a little bit about the ministry here in Bolivia and how you can be involved and be a part of what we're doing through your prayers and your financial support.
The main focus of our ministry in Bolivia is Genesis Cochabamba. Genesis is a church plant that we started about a year ago. The goal is to reach out to the younger people of Bolivia. We realized over our 5 years in Bolivia that most churches are made of people that are in an adult age or also with little children, but the youth are being disenchanted and left behind. Genesis is made about 80% of people from ages 17 to 35. It's a modern church, a contemporary church, with a message that is relevant to their everyday life. Genesis is a place where you will find a sense of community, where you're welcome no matter who you are or where you come from. But it is also a place where you're going to be challenged, to be transformed by the power of the Holy Spirit and by the power of the Word of God.
Genesis Cochabamba is all about reaching people who are new to a relationship with Christ. Most of the people who are coming are either young in their walk with God or have just recently received Christ. We've been able to see amazing things happen, from baptisms to many people receiving Christ as their Lord and Savior. And also, our heart is to not just stop there, but to help with discipleship, to where people can truly grow in their day-to-day life and see how the Holy Spirit can guide them in every decision, every word, every thought that they have. Another aspect that is really big on our hearts with Genesis Cochabamba is outreach. We want people to not only see Christ in their life and how He can help them, but also in turn, they can help others. One of the main areas of outreach at Genesis Cochabamba is partnering with a local orphanage. Each Sunday, we provide transportation for the kids from the orphanage to be able to come and be a part of the service here at Genesis. Another thing that we do is we work with them regularly, going and teaching Bible lessons, celebrating each of their birthdays, Christmas, and just living life with them. We want the kids to know that they are loved by God and they are totally a part of our family. In addition to that, we work with an inner city outreach for children, and we work with two schools in mountain villages here in Cochabamba. Our heart there is to teach them God's love, to raise them up, to work with them, to share snacks, provide their practical needs, and to just love on the kids. Another area that we're working on right now is partnering with another organization that has a big heart and a big program with the homeless ministry and with youth in local schools. One of our biggest areas of focus here at Genesis is getting out and to go beyond what we can do for ourselves and to reach others.
And you know, you can also be a part of this. We would love for you to come and visit us on a short-term trip here in Cochabamba, Bolivia.
We've been asked numerous times why we like short-term missions so much, and the answer is pretty simple. It's a huge blessing. It's a blessing to the people and the country that you're visiting. It's a blessing to us as missionaries, and it's also a blessing to each person who goes on the trip, as God really does a work in their lives and has just a great impact. Another reason is because Jonathan and I first got our start with missions by going on short-term trips. We were able to see the ministry, see what was being done, and God really put it on our hearts to become full-time missionaries. What happens if you come on a missions trip here to Bolivia and work with us? You'll have a great opportunity. To be completely honest, you'll experience a new culture, a new language. Also, you'll get to experience some really delicious food like they have here in Cochabamba. I personally love it a lot. You'll also get to work with us side by side in the ministry here. Talking to people, sharing God's love. You can do construction projects, work with the orphanage, go to the village school. A lot of the things that we do on a daily basis, you'll get to be a part of. Some of the projects that we have that may take us a long time to get accomplished, when we have a team come, we can get a lot done in a much shorter amount of time. Mission trips really do make a huge difference, and they're important to us. So we would love for you to be able to come and be a part of missions here. And additionally, we also offer an internship program. If you're interested in coming for a month, 2 months, or even three, we can talk to you about all the options of coming as an intern. We would love for you to get involved with the ministry here in Bolivia. You can do that through your prayers, you can do that through coming on a missions trip or an internship, and you can also do it through your financial support. Jonathan and I, as missionaries, are responsible to raise 100% of the funds that we need to be able to live and serve here. The funds that we need for ministry and all of the other areas that we help are our responsibility to raise. We do that through partnering with churches, through families and individuals in the U.S. and in other places that feel in their heart that they want to be a part of what's going on here in Bolivia. So we'd love to invite you to be a part of what's going on, and you can have a huge impact on the people here through your prayers, support, and your visits.
We're here for you. If you want to talk to us, if you have any questions, please feel free to contact us, and we expect to hear from you. God bless you.
Thank you.
That is just out of sight, wonderful. What a difference you can make. I love it all, but especially the orphanage. I guess we should let the kids go. Second grade and under, you're dismissed. You have teachers tonight. The rest of you, if you can get stay out here and get a vision for missions, we're just delighted you're here. Who's going first, Kara or you? Okay, together, that's good.
Good evening, everyone. It is such an honor for us to be back here at New Life. We're so excited to see everyone. It really does feel like we're visiting family. So thank you all for receiving us and being so welcoming and loving. And we're just so excited to share about what God's doing in Bolivia. It really is amazing to me to see His hand in what's going on, because I know it has absolutely nothing to do with us, like us doing it, right? It's totally God working in the lives of people in Bolivia, and we are so thankful. About a year ago, we started Genesis Cochabamba, and it's been really amazing. We started with small groups, with people who, really, the truth of the matter is, they started asking us questions about Jesus. The majority of them had no relationship with God whatsoever, or they went to a church two or three times in their life. So they had heard who Jesus was, but they didn't really know much about Him. So people started asking us questions, so we started getting together and talking about the Lord, and then it started growing, and we split the groups into two, and then it just kept growing, and we realized these people need to grow even more. They need somewhere to go. They need community. And so that's how Genesis Cochabamba started. It's been a blessing to see people coming and just receiving the love of Christ, just being transformed by His power, and I'm loving it. The girls from the orphanage are my babies. Like, I love them so much. When we were starting to plant the church, that was my heart, was that the children from the orphanage need to come to church. They need to feel part of our family and not feel like they're the orphans that we help. You know what I mean? But feel like they are a part of the family. And I am super excited about that, because when they first started coming to church, you could tell they were a little cautious, didn't really know what to expect. But now they walk into the church and they own the place. Like, they know that is their home and they are part of the family. And to me, just being able to see the change in their lives over the 5 years that we've been there, and how God really is restoring them, helping them to feel how they truly are seen by Him, that they're loved by Him. Anyway, I could talk on and on and on forever, as you saw in the video. Thank you all. Your prayers and your support really do have an amazing impact, and we're so thankful. We truly, truly are. So I'm going to give you an opportunity to talk now. So thank you all so much.
Thank you. She said that she doesn't like to preach, but I think she does. I think in her heart, I'm just going to step up here to turn this on. Yeah, it's
It's an honor to be here. It's a privilege. And we were talking with Sherry. It's been 8 years since we first met. And you know what's funny? I met Kara and Sherry on the exact same mission trip. So it was 2008 in Guatemala, Totonicapán. I'm from Bolivia, but I was in Guatemala. I was in Living Water Teaching on the Bible School. And that's where we all met. That's where it all started. And yeah, I'm not going to embarrass Christiana. anyway, no, but I mean, most of the guys are just adults now, and it's so exciting, you know. We always talk with Kara about how inspiring it is for us to see the good work that you're doing with the youth group and your training, because so many of them are just following God and living up, making the difference, you know, really living their lives the way God intended them to live their lives. And in this age and time, it's really a huge blessing to have such a great rate of success with your young adults and your teenagers. And it's just, I think it's just the Holy Spirit. It couldn't be anything else, because every church has a program. But the programs will not make a difference in people's lives. They are just tools, right? What will make a difference in people's lives is the Holy Spirit and praying for them and just pouring out to them and giving them a good community opportunity. So I just want to share that a little bit, because we do love you, and some of you probably don't know us because we come every other year. Some of you probably remember us. Some of the ones that we really know are probably not here anymore because they are all over the country right now. But we do love you, pray for you, and we remember you, and we appreciate your prayers and your support. They mean a lot to us. As you could see on the video, that's what's going on in Bolivia. It's a church plant, and it's a huge blessing. And just over in this first year, we have seen 15 people being baptized at the church, which is a huge blessing to us. And a couple of them that are very dear to me, because one of them is one of my best friends from college. And when we moved back to Bolivia from Guatemala, he reached out to me through Facebook. You know, God bless Facebook when you use it right. And he said, "You're back in town, let's get together." We got together to eat sarteñas, a local delicacy. And he started asking me about what we believe. You know, you became a Christian, what's going on, what is that all about? And we started talking, and he liked the idea. And so we started a small group, and they started coming with his wife. They started coming to church. And the Sunday before we came to the U.S. this time, they got baptized, him and his wife. Yeah, amen. So when we were baptizing them, we gave them the opportunity to share with the church why they're getting baptized, like what it means to them and everything. So this guy, he was a party boy, you know, he wouldn't miss a weekend before. And now he's coming to church, and they are raising their little baby 1 year old in church. And he was almost in tears. I think a few tears came down his face when I asked him to share why he was getting baptized. And he said, "Well, my whole life I heard about God, but I never knew I could have this kind of relationship with him." And he was like, "I know I have long ways to go, but I'm excited about this, you know, and I really want to know him better. I really want to experience his love more and more, and I really want to share his love with others." And these are his words. And to me, it was like seeing this life being changed, you know, and it reminds you that it's about this is real people, you know. It's not about big numbers. It's not about huge success. It's about one step at a time, one life at a time, but to really introduce them to the love of God and really a transforming power of the Holy Spirit and the Word of God. There's nothing else. There's nothing else to it, you know. It's His job. It's God's job. Our job is just to tell them about Jesus. And it's God's job to do the difference in their lives. And we all need to learn to remember who we are and who He is, right? We are not the ones making the change, He is. Amen?
Amen?
So I just wanted to share with you a little bit of that, what's going on in Bolivia. We're seeing God performing these amazing miracles, changing lives every day. So please do keep us in your prayers for that. And now, changing the subject, I want to share with you a little bit from the Word of God, a little message that we have in our hearts. But let's pray first. Amen?
Amen.
Father, we love you so much. We love you so very much. And it really is an honor and a privilege to be here and to share from your word, Father, with this amazing church, this community. And we're just vessels. And we pray today that it's your Spirit talking and ministering to each one of us, and that you will translate this message for something that we can all apply and something that will speak to each one of our lives and just make us take a step of faith and come closer to you every day of our lives, Father. Thank you for this opportunity, and we bless you. We bless the name of Jesus, and we thank you. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Can we read Luke? Can you go in your Bibles with me? I'm going to read from the NIV version. Hope that's okay. You know, my first language is Spanish, and I preach in Spanish, so I need to stick with that easy version that I can use. So Luke 9, chapter 9, verse 23. Jesus is talking to the disciples, and then he said to them all, "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross daily and follow me." If you want to be a disciple of Jesus, you need to deny yourself, pick up your cross daily, and follow him. Amen?
Amen.
So I want us to just hold on to this verse for a minute. Just put it on a little shelf, but don't let it go, because we're going to come back to this in a moment. But I want us to remember that Jesus, he was speaking to his disciples, and we are his disciples. Amen?
Amen.
So he's speaking to us, and he's saying, if you want to be my disciple, you really, really want to be my disciple, what you need to do, like my mother-in-law likes to say that, what you need to do. So, what you need to do, Jesus was saying, you need to deny yourself, pick up your cross daily, and follow him. Amen?
Yeah.
Now let me ask you a question. What defines you? What defines you as a person? What defines you as a human being? What defines success in your life? Anything that defines you that is not Jesus is an idol. And today I want to share with you a little message that is called, I named it, the challenge of Joshua. Remember Joshua? He was Moses' successor. Moses got old. God told him, you need to pass the baton to someone else that's going to lead the people. And God chose Joshua. And Joshua led the people to conquer the promised land. Amen?
Amen.
Okay, so Joshua had a very successful military career, right? He led about 2 million people, give or take, into an unknown land. They weren't there before. They never saw it before. They didn't have Google Maps. So they just needed to go and just conquer. They found a bunch of different enemies, and they had to go and fight them. And at the beginning, they were the underdog, right? They didn't go to a war before. They were enslaved in Egypt for 400 years. They didn't know how to fight or what to do, but they were just trusting God and going through and defeating every enemy. By the time they got to certain towns, they were like, oh, the Israelites are coming. We might as well just surrender, because we heard what their God can do. So Joshua kind of defines success. Right? He's a conqueror, he's a leader, he's a successor of Moses. Amen?
Yeah.
I mean, if someone can step up and say, I figured it out, that was Joshua. Amen?
Yeah.
But before Joshua, a little before that happened, God gave something to Moses. 2 big pieces of rock that have 10 statements that God himself wrote there.
Right.
The 10 Commandments. Amen?
Amen?
And the first one says, you shall have no other gods before me.
Right.
Amen?
Amen?
So Joshua, I believe, the Bible doesn't say exactly this, but I do believe that while Joshua was conquering and leading the people, the Israelites, into the promised land, he kept this in mind. He kept this idea in mind. There is 10 commandments that we need to keep, that we must keep. This is God's will for us. Amen?
Yeah.
Now, Martin Luther, you all know who Martin Luther was, right? Big reformer. He said, You cannot break any of the other commandments without breaking the first one. You will not break any of the others unless you break the first one. Because if you really don't put anything before God, then you're just going to follow God.
Amen.
And you're going to keep the others. Amen?
Amen?
But when you lose track of who God is and who you are, and what that relationship should be, then it's very easy to start breaking the others.
Yeah.
It's very easy to commit adultery, to covet your neighbor's possessions, to say, to lie, to kill. Because when you lose track of who God is, then your moral compass is not pointing in the right direction anymore. And we don't need to go too far away to see it. We just see the results of our new modern secular society.
Amen?
Amen? There is no standard of morality anymore because there is no one to hold you accountable.
Come on.
If there is no God in your mind, if there is no God in your heart, then I'm sorry, but you're nothing else than a highly evolved monkey. I mean, you either have God or you have nothing. That's what it comes down to. Amen? So Joshua had this in his head. I don't think he had this elaborated idea, but I don't think he was struggling with people that believed they were monkeys. But he was struggling anyway with people that didn't know God, they didn't worship God. So he conquered. But at the end of his days, when he was getting ready to retire, he stood tall in front of the whole people of Israel. And he challenged them. Because he knew this. He knew, this is how I left my life. How I lived, sorry, my life. This is how I led these people. But my time is passing. And someone else is going to lead them. So I am going to challenge them and leave them with something that they can always remember, just like Moses did. Joshua 24:15. Book of Joshua, chapter 24, verse 15. He's looking at the people of Israel. He's about to retire. He's been a general his whole life. He's been through war. He's conquered. And he looks at them and says, "But if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve. Whether the gods your ancestors served beyond the Euphrates, or the gods of the Amorites, in whose land you are living. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord."
Amen?
Amen. So Joshua is standing tall in front of the people that he's led for so many years through conquering the promised land. And he's about to retire. And he's not thinking about his retirement plan, his real estate, or anything like that. He's thinking about what's going to happen with them. And he says, "I'm going to leave them with something they can hold on to and remember every day of their lives." And the challenge is very easy. Choose yourselves whom you're going to serve. Amen?
Amen.
And we can see that the Old Testament is not that different from the New Testament when you read it from the right perspective. Because it was still a personal choice back then. They still needed to choose. Who are you going to serve? And Joshua presents them with three basic groups of gods that they could worship. Now, let's get first out of the way the big elephant in the room, okay? There's one option that is not there. The option that is not there is worship nothing. He says, or maybe you can choose and worship anything and just go through life not worshiping anything. That's not an option because whether you admit it or not, everybody worships something.
Right.
Worshiping nothing is your own worship. Okay? You're worshiping the idea that you don't worship anything. Because that's what defines you. Remember, whatever defines you is your God. Are you following me? Yeah? Whatever defines who you are is who you worship or what you worship. So in worshiping, quote-unquote, nothing, is what you decide to worship. That's what defines you. And people go their whole lives making a big fuss about how they do not believe in anything. Well, you are. But, so that's out of the way, right? That's not an option. We're not even going to discuss it. It's not even an option. So Joshua leaves them with three options. Three real options.
Right.
You can worship the gods of your parents. You can worship the gods of your culture, your society. Or you can worship the Lord our God. Amen?
Amen.
Now we came down to a point where most people in the 21st century will stand up and say, but that's a thing from the past. Idolatry doesn't exist anymore. We don't bow down to anything. Because we picture idolatry as we have some big golden calf and we're all worshiping the golden calf. So since we don't do that anymore, then idolatry doesn't exist. Right? Yeah. No. Wrong. Because again, remember, whatever defines you is your God. Is that you worship. Okay? So the first option, and this is where what I want to focus today, because I want each one of us, as we speak tonight, to let the Holy Spirit talk to us and maybe make us realize and open our eyes that maybe, just maybe, we've been keeping some idols in our tent. Amen? Let me tell you something before that. You know what happened after that? Even a little before that, you know what the Israelites have a tendency to do? They used to keep their little tokens in their tents.
Right.
They used to like to keep their little idols on their tents.
Right.
So out in the open, they were all worship Yahweh,
right,
the Lord. But when they go back in, they wanted to keep their little God, just in case. You know, just in case God doesn't come true, just in case God doesn't work, well, I have this little thing here that I'm going to worship. This little golden statue. Even Joseph, which then became to be called Israel, had his little idols. Remember, God actually told him to get rid of them. And many of them had their little hidden idols inside their tents. And that's what we have a tendency to do nowadays. And it becomes so common in us that we don't even realize that we have them. It was so ingrained in the Israelites that they didn't even realize what they were doing. In their heads, they were worshiping God with all they were. Because, you know, their public worship, their culture, their law, their state, everything was aligned to the law of God. So, hey, we're worshiping God. But God wants your heart in the private as much as He wants your heart in the open. Amen?
Amen?
So, sometimes nowadays we have the tendency to do the same thing. We keep these little tokens in our tents that nobody knows, but they are taking the place of God. And the first can be the gods of your parents, the gods of your ancestors.
Right.
And they have many faces nowadays. Sure. Have you ever met a workaholic?
Right.
Have you ever met someone that worships status? Or titles?
Right.
Or position? Or worships food? Or worships, I don't know, his talent. You know, your talent can become your idol. You know, I'm the guitar player on the worship band of the church, and nobody plays guitar better than I do. God has called me to be a guitar player. There's nothing wrong with that. But when it becomes what defines you, then you're not worshiping God anymore. You're worshiping the talent that God has given you.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
So, but that comes, for example, most of the times. Have you realized that you usually grow up saying, I'm not going to be like my mom, I'm not going to be like my dad, I'm not going to be like my dad. And then one day you wake up and you're like, I'm exactly like my dad. I'm exactly like my mom. And you look at yourself and you're like, when did that happen? And you know, what we teach our children at home is going to define who they are.
Come on.
So if that is a workaholic, many times without realizing or wanting to, son is going to become a workaholic himself. If status or position or whatever Was something so important in your house that you do everything to look good in the eyes of others? That your children are going to grow up wanting to look good in the eyes of others and being a people's pleaser.
Right.
If food is your idol, then you're going to teach your children to live for food, right? They don't eat to live, they live to eat. But Joshua is looking at them and telling them, you need to choose. Are you going to worship the gods of your parents, the gods of your ancestors, or are you going to worship the Lord our God? Amen?
Amen.
So it's good every once in a while. It's very good to be like our parents, especially if we have good parents, right? It's a blessing, it's an encouragement. You realize, I am doing exactly what my dad did, and many times it's a good thing. So there's nothing wrong with that. But sometimes you can catch yourself worshiping what your dad worshiped. And you, or your mom. And you know what? That's not a condemnation message. It's an encouraging message to realize, you know, to open your eyes and say, you know, daddy wasn't perfect. Nobody is. We are not perfect.
Right.
But we have the grace of God to overcome the shortcomings of our ancestors. Amen?
Amen?
So if there was an idol in our household, that doesn't mean that now you need to say, oh, my dad was an idolater, he wasn't a true Christian, he made mistakes. We all do. It's a way of saying, Lord, thank you for the great parents that you gave me, but thank you also for opening up my eyes to the reality. Help me change it. Amen?
Amen?
So we need to remember that even when God is calling us to change something in our life, His call comes from grace. Amen?
Amen.
His call comes from love.
Yes.
And we need to have a spirit of repentance, but also of gratefulness.
Amen.
For the blessings that we have.
Amen?
Amen. So that's the first God you can worship. And you know, you can have a mixture of all these gods. It's not like you just have one. These Israelites have a bunch of little tokens in their tents. You know, it's not like they have just one. They have a bunch of little ones to see if God doesn't work, one of these will. Right? If God doesn't come true, then probably the lottery will. You know? I believe God for provision, but I buy a ticket every day. You know what I'm saying? Again, I'm not saying there's wrong to buy the lottery or it is. You need to this. But what I'm saying is, you put your trust on something else just in case. That's my point. Amen?
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
So I'm believing that God will do it, but I also will have my little backup just in case God doesn't figure it out. And then it comes to the gods of our culture. And these are even harder to figure out. Because some of them are very stand out. You can see them right away. All you need to do is turn on the TV. And when you turn on the TV, you will see that they are always trying to sell you a savior.
They are.
Any commercial in between shows will tell you if you're unhappy, if you're lonely, if you're bored, buy this and that, and you'll be saved from your unhappiness. Amen?
Yeah.
If you're unhappy with how you look, purchase this product, and you'll be saved. If you're unhappy with your house, get this deal, and you'll be saved. And they make you believe that you're so smart that you're getting the best out of it, right? But they are never going to offer you a deal where they lose. They wouldn't be on business. Amen?
Yeah.
So, TV is trying to sell you a savior. Then there's these new idols of our culture. How many likes did you get? Right? Well, you go to a pastor's convention. Well, how many followers does your church have on Facebook? I have 2,000K. How many do you have? And you're like, oh, yeah, from failing, I only have 500 people following me. Our culture is constantly trying to put pressure on us to define ourselves, define our families, define our success in our ministry based on what the culture is selling at the moment. Amen?
Yeah.
Now you call it social media, and before it could be phone calls, how many phone calls do your ministers receive, and before that, how many letters do you get, and there's always, you know, it's the same basic thing, it's just modernized. Right? Solomon says there's nothing new under the sun. Just comes in different shapes and forms now. So some of these cultural idols we can spot right on. Yeah? If you're a strong Christian, you turn on the TV, you see that they are selling you a savior of the way you look like, you realize I'm not defined for how I look like, I'm defined for who God says I am. So you can spot that right on and say, this is an idol of my culture, I'm not going to bow down to this one. But there are some other idols of our culture that are probably a little harder to figure out. Like I was saying, for example, you define yourselves on how many likes you get on Facebook. And that's very easy to fall for that. Is it good to have likes as a church? Absolutely, you're reaching out people, but will that define your ministry? Are you going to start living life and ministering to people just to get likes? Might as well become a politician. And then you turn on the news and what do you see is division. Division. Everybody's arguing with everybody. They don't even know what they are arguing about. They just need to argue. And the TV is set up in a way that is going to put people to argue so they can make you mad so you can continue watch to see if they ever figure out. It's like a bad TV soap opera, you know? The ones that you used to see in the middle of the morning where you're like following the same people for 10 years trying to figure out if they're ever going to get married. It's the same that you see on the news. You have the guy from the right, the guy from the left, and they're screaming at each other, and the guy on the middle is just laughing at both of them. And Ken, if he could see you through the camera, he would be laughing at you too, saying, I'm just keeping you here, following us, because their idols are ratings, and they are selling you another idol that is division. And we need to realize, now we cannot live on a bubble. Jesus said, you're not of this world, but you are in this world. Amen? So we cannot live on a bubble. We cannot say, well, I throw away the TV, I throw away Facebook, I throw away Twitter, I throw away everything, and we become Amish. I think a little funny too. I'll see my wife's face as well. But we need to make an impact in our culture. We need to use social media. We need to know what's going on. There's a place to watch the news. Amen? Yeah. We need to keep up with what's going on to make a real difference. But again, when keeping up with what's going on is what defines you, then you made an idol out of it.
Right.
Amen?
Right.
So, we have two sets of idols. The idols in our household, those that are hidden in our tents, that our parents have, and they didn't even know they had them. And we need to realize and say, maybe this is becoming an idol in my house. Maybe I've been putting too much emphasis on this instead of putting emphasis on God. Maybe I've been pressuring my kids a little too much on these standards because I worship these standards.
Oh,
yeah.
So we need to pray to the Lord and say, help me realize if this has been going on in my heart. And help me get rid of this. He can do it, we can't. And then there's the idols of our culture, and we need to do the same prayer. God, remind me, I am in this world, but I am not of this world.
Right.
Amen?
Amen.
So, Joshua looks at his people, and he tells them, he challenges them, and says, you know, you can choose whom you will serve. The gods of your ancestors, who didn't know God. The gods of your culture that does not know God. But as for me and my family, we will serve the Lord.
Amen.
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 Well, do you remember the first verse that we read? When Jesus said, if you're going to be my disciple, you need to deny yourself every day, pick up your cross and follow me.
Right.
Well, this is where Joshua and Jesus will connect. Because that challenge of Joshua, when he says, decide whom you will serve. The tense of the Hebrew implies an ongoing, constant decision.
Yeah.
It's not a decision you make once in your life. It's not like being born again. When you're born again once and forever. Jesus gives you new life. Amen?
Yeah.
But deciding to follow him is a decision that you need to make every single day of your life. Joshua wasn't telling the Israelites, decide today, in the sense that today you're going to decide, it's going to be decided forever. If that were the case, then we wouldn't have the Old Testament, because the Old Testament is the story of the shortcomings of the Israelites. So it's not a one-time decision. He was telling them, remember as a nation, and remember as families, and remember as individuals, who are you going to serve every day of your lives? Amen?
Yeah.
And God is telling us the same. Remember as a church, remember as families, and remember as individuals, who are you going to serve today? Who you served yesterday, it doesn't matter. His mercies are new every day. Who are you going to serve today? And you know what? If you fell short today, it doesn't matter. You can repent and move on. As long as you are humble enough to admit and repent. Now, you know, repentance comes with change. There's a difference between repent and regret. Amen? I'm not saying you can regret every day. What kind of life is that? I regret every single day of my life. But we can repent every day. Amen?
Amen?
We have a lawyer in heaven. But it's a decision that we need to make every day. Choose today who are you going to serve. And then that's where Jesus comes. Because Joshua gives you the challenge. And he says, choose. But he doesn't tell you how to do it. But Jesus comes and tells you how to do it. And he says, deny yourself, pick up your cross, and follow me.
Yeah.
Deny yourself, pick up your cross, and follow. Now, finishing with this, the cross, we have a beautiful cross there. It's gorgeous, I love it. But today, the cross is a symbol of hope. It's a symbol of Christianity, right?
Yeah.
When Jesus said this, that wasn't the case.
No.
It was the instrument of death.
Right.
Amen? Mm-hmm. It's like someone comes to you today and tells you, if you want to be my disciple, sit down every day on your electric chair
right.
and follow me. Pretty much Jesus was telling them, you need to be ready to die to yourself every day. You need to be ready to die to you every day. Denying yourself doesn't mean anything else than dying to you. Denying yourself doesn't mean what a tradition, especially in the Catholic Church, used to teach. Denying yourself is torturing yourself, you know? Don't look for any pleasure. Don't look for any happiness. The holy people are those who deny everything to themselves. That's not what Jesus is talking about. He's not here to torture you.
Come on.
He's telling you, deny your flesh. Deny those things that don't bring you to me.
Come on.
Deny those things that don't bring glory to the name of Jesus. Deny those things that are defining you that are not God.
Right.
Amen? So dying to yourself every day basically means when you pray to God and tell Him, God, I want to give you this day. I want to serve you this day. I want to worship you this day.
Amen.
Then you also pray and say, Lord, help me realize what is taking your place in my life.
Yes.
Then that's when denying yourself happens. Because if your standards, if your goals, if your ministry, if your talents, if your food, if your bank account, if whatever it is taking the place of God, then that's when you need to decide which one comes first.
Right.
Amen?
Yeah.
And most of these things are not bad within themselves. Food is good, we need it, right? Money is good, we surely need it and want it, right? Everything else is good on the right place, but not when it takes the place of God.
Yeah.
Amen?
Amen?
Exodus 20, God says that He's a jealous God. God, Exodus 24, yeah. Can we go to verse 5, please? Thank you. Yeah. The Lord, your God, I am a jealous God. Jealous God means that God is not willing to share you. God is as willing to share your heart as your spouse is willing to share your heart. Amen? He wants your heart entirely. He wants you entirely for Him. Amen? So worshiping Him means giving Him your whole. Means giving Him everything you are. Your dreams, your possessions, your family, your health. Everything you have belongs to Him. And we know he's a faithful God. We know we cannot trust anyone better than him to take care of all those things. Amen?
Amen.
So, I will ask you to stand on your feet, please. When I was first studying for this message, it challenged me. And every time I share this message, it challenges me. Because again, it's a message for every day. It's not one thing that you say one time and you're done with it. It's a challenge of every day. The challenge of Joshua is a challenge of every day. The challenge of Jesus is a challenge of every day. So I feel honored again and privileged to be able to share with you tonight. We are here, as you know, sharing about Bolivia and the ministry there. If you want to know a little bit more about Bolivia and what we do, we're going to be outside. Please feel free to talk to us. We have some magnets that are free to take. Please take one home. Just put it on your fridge or wherever and pray for us. But besides talking about Bolivia and what God is doing there, which is great, I did. Pastor Denise asked me to share from the Word, and I take it as a privilege.
Yeah.
And I did pray. We were praying with Kara. You know, if we're invited to preach somewhere, what does God want us to say? And this was a message that God gave us to share with you. And to share with God gave it to share with myself too, because I need to remember this every day.
Yeah.
So I want to ask all of us tonight to pray for a few minutes and not let it go as a good message. Oh, it was so exciting. The pastor talked so good. What did he talk about? I have no idea, but it was great. I want us to pray for just a few minutes, all of us. And if you can just quietly close your eyes and bow down your head and just pray together. Ask God with me to help us realize what is defining us. Lord, we really thank you tonight. We are so honored to be your children. Your word says that we love you because you loved us first. We have nothing to give you, really. And even so, you decided to love us. You gave your life for us. You rescued us and gave us everlasting life. And not just that, but your mercy is new every morning. Every morning with you is a new opportunity. Thank you, Lord, because our shortcomings, our mistakes, cannot separate us from you, Father. Your love is bigger than anything. But Father, we're not here to just dwell on the fact that we know that you love us. We're here to love you back.
Yes.
Father, we want to love you with passion. We understand that our love is never going to compare to the greatness of your love. But you have placed your love in our hearts. You have given us your spirit, Father, so we can even begin to understand what real love is. Tonight we just pray that you help us to learn to love you more. And to live up to this challenge that you have for us. To choose every day whom we're going to serve. It's not easy, we know that. Without you opening up our eyes, we probably don't even realize what we're worshiping. Without you opening up our eyes, we don't realize what our culture is worshiping outside. But when you open up our eyes, Father, you give us this power, this anointing to be able to overcome and to conquer in you. And I pray tonight for each one of us, each one of the families that is represented here. And we also pray, Father, for those who have come through these doors over the years, and for some reason or the other, they have been taken away, Father, by the enemy, by the lies of this world. We pray that all of us will come together and worship you. We pray that you're going to talk to the hearts, Father, of the people that have fallen away from you, Father. We pray for those that are here tonight, that we're going to be encouraged to follow you every day and to live a godly life every day. We pray for the children that are growing up in this church, in this ministry, Father, that they are going to grow up to know you, to live a life with you, to walk with you every single day of their lives, Father. We pray that everything we do, everywhere we go, we will just bring glory to your name, Father. May you be the one who defines us, who we are in every step that we take. We want to live a life of obedience, Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We bless your glory name tonight. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you.